Hello, and welcome to another edition of UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Assistant Professor of History at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host. Recently, the University of the District of Columbia Journalism Club presented a public forum entitled Runnels of Blood in the Black Community, How to Stop the Violence and Murders. I was a member of the panel, and on this edition of UDC Forum, I will continue the discussion of how to stop the violence in the Black community with one of my co-panelists, Barry LeNoir, president of the United Black Fund. Many of you will remember that the United Black Fund was founded by the late Dr. Calvin Rolark, who also founded the Washington Informer. Dr. Rolark's co-founder was his late wife, former DC council member, attorney Wilhelmina J. Rolark. The United Black Fund is in its 44th year. Barry LeNoir received his Bachelor of Science degree in psychology from Howard University and his Juris Doctor degree from Howard University School of Law. A child of the civil rights movement, Barry was present at the 1963 March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. He participated in the march from Selma to Montgomery, Alabama in 1965 and volunteered in the Poor People's Campaign in 1968. He is also chair of the Maryland State Unit of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. Barry served as program director at Columbia Heights Youth Club at All Souls Unitarian Church, and he held the position of senior operating office with Crawford Edgewood Managers, Inc., one of the nation's leading minority community development and multifamily housing management firms. In 2007, he launched a national program to reduce violence. The campaign was conducted in 40 cities in the United States. The campaign will continue through 2015. Welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Barber. It's a joy and honor to be here with you today.
Glad to have you. Very accomplished, and I see that you're a Howard University graduate as well.
I am, and you know, I cherish and recommend that nurturing experience that comes from universities like Howard, UDC, and others that know how to put their arms around you as you learn and grow and study, and help guide your growth. So I'm a beneficiary of that at Howard University.
And that's exactly what we do here. We're looking to massage and cultivate and grow a global student as well. Tell us about your position at the United Black Fund and the direction it's heading in the 21st century.
You know, it's historically the United Black Fund was started in 1969 by Calvin and Wilhelmina Rolark, incredible community leaders, community servants really, giant community servants. But it's an outgrowth of the Poor People's Campaign. Calvin and Wilhelmina were volunteers in that campaign. And if you look at our mission is to work with black and poor people of whatever ethnic or racial origin. And so our mission in conducting that mission, historically, we've focused on young people and seniors and the issues of the day. Today's issues that we deal with are how do we help organize our community to better serve the needs that press against black people and poor people? How do we help people develop organizations that effectively attack and meet the challenges of growth, of education, economic challenges. So today we're working with 103 organizations throughout the Washington metropolitan area, all of whom are taking a slice of those needs as their own mission. For example, we work with organizations like Concerned Black Men, RAP, Hospital for Sick Children, or at least HSC Pediatric Services, and others that are doing their best to begin to minimize those forces that dehumanize people and reduce people. And they're working to enlarge and grow people. So we're having a great time being loyal to our mission of working to meet the challenges of the day in our community.
Do you provide empowerment? You provide education, resources? How are you assisting these organizations to combat the issues they find and challenges they find in their communities?
Well, first of all, Dr. Barber, we help them position themselves in campaigns. We're a partner organization with the United Way of the National Capital Area. I think they conduct the most important campaign in our community because it's a campaign that does, through employers, allows employees to donate to nonprofits based on their understanding of what their mission is and their accomplishments are, through payroll deductions, which makes the donation easier to give. when it's a smaller portions over time. And then through that, we also connect them to the combined federal campaign, which is the biggest campaign of its sort in the Washington area. Last year, federal employees, with their generosity, gave over $62 million to nonprofits. And they do this every year. So the first responsibility we have is to help people position themselves to get the resources they need to do the good work they want to do. The other thing we do is we help them shape their ideas. And we help them target their ideas at populations that are in need of service. And so we will help organizations with proposal development. We'll have sessions on strategy development. How do you make your organization more effective? How do you compete in a global world where the internet is now being a source of great revenue and information? And so that's a responsibility we have to the organizations that work with us. The other responsibilities we have are to conduct the programs that over time have been targeted and specially customized to deal with problems in our community. And I'll give you an example. We have a program that we're starting now in this time of year, every year, in the spring season, the Isle of Life campaign. And it's a campaign that was founded 20 years ago when there was a high level of violence in the Washington, D.C. area. And the level of violence was almost pandemic in the early 90s. So we set up a campaign that allows children in school from first grade through 12th grade to express their love for life, either by doing a poster or writing a song or doing an essay or doing an oration. And they can compete in this contest citywide to win cash awards. So for seniors, for example, the cash award for the winner in these categories would be a $400 cash award. And even for first graders and third graders, the cash award is pretty high for them. So these programs allow kids to talk about issues differently. It gives them an opportunity to express their views and connect with the theme of life. And one of the things we have to do more in our community, as you know, is to begin to celebrate life in ways that really bring a message of respect, a message of joy, a message of appreciation, and a message that allows kids to engage life positively. And so this program that we have now, we're extending for the first time in PG County. Sadly, in Prince George's County this year, six students have lost their lives in four high schools in Prince George's County. So we've talked with the principals at those schools and the school board members out there in Prince George's County. So we're putting this program for the first time in Friendly High School, in Suitland High School, in Central High School, and in Flowers High School, to give those children an opportunity to talk about these issues too. You know, when we get kids to talk about the right things and talk about them with their friends, it helps guide the steps they take. And I know there's an expression, you can't walk the walk unless you talk the talk. And that's what really we kind of believe in. So that's an example of one of the programs we do that's customized to the issues of the day, particularly among young people. So we have a number of programs like that. We do a program in Black History Invitational Swimming Meet, which in the Black History Month will bring in 960 kids from all over the country. You may never hear about it in the newspapers, but let me tell you, it's one of the most positive events you can experience when kids from Miami, from Harlem, from Los Angeles, from Philadelphia and places, Detroit, come together with kids in Washington to compete as swimmers. This is a program that Calvin Rolark and a fellow by the name of Bill Rumsey started. Bill was a great guy. He used to run the D.C. Department of Parks and Recreation. And so they said, we have to do something to get kids involved in something other than basketball and football. And so they came up with this great combination of ideas that allowed kids to swim competitively against each other. And it's grown into the biggest meet of its sort in the country. The most diverse event in the country comes from this swimming meet. So we do that program as well. And we have a number of other programs that we customize and sponsor for the sake of targeting various problems, specific problems in our community.
You're doing extremely well, and you're doing great things, but how are you measuring your success? How are you seeing the benefits, or how can you tell the impact that you're making?
Well, one of the things we see, if we look at each of our programs, is the level of participation. The extent to which, for example, in the I Love Life program, the extent to which we're engaging not just the student, but the student body and the administration of the school. The extent to which a school community can come in to support ideas like this. And we're seeing a growth in that way. The level of participation gives us another read for that. Our participation rates are steadily increasing in these programs. And then the feedback we get from people who participate in these programs 4, 5, 10 years after they do that, that tell us, the letters we get, the calls we get to say, thank you for this, I still remember this, or do you still have my poster? Or do you still have my essay? Can I get a hold of that? So we have to measure it in different ways. But mostly it's feedback and our own observations about the extent to which people are enjoying and really engaging the things we're offering.
How do you find the families and the community are embracing this? Do you get a lot of family participation? Is that required when you are conducting the programs?
And some of the programs we do seek family participation. One of the programs we have is a back-to-school program, which is solely for the benefit of parents joining with school administrators and teachers to engage a child's school experience. So we offer a competition among schools. Mm-hmm. What school, based on its enrollment, will get the highest percentage of parents out on the first day of school? What school can sustain that parent involvement for the necessary or the important moments of the school's curriculum during the year? And so we have a back-to-school program that focuses on that parent and family, the essential units to make a child whole and healthy, and make a child's learning experience at school something that connects to the environment outside of school. You know, children only spend 20% of their growing up years in school. The other 80% is spent at home and in the communities. And so we have to find ways to connect the experience at school more directly with, and over a sustained period, with the experience that kids are having after school and on weekends. And so this program gives us connection with the children, the family, the teachers, and then we can extend that connection back into the community where we know most of the growing up takes place.
You had mentioned earlier that 20 years ago you were looking at a murder rate that was almost pandemic.
That's right.
And that has certainly subsided. But now we see, even though it's lower, there is still, unfortunately, that trend of murders each weekend. We're getting different numbers and we're losing our young people. But we're also seeing high numbers of children in homeless shelters. Do you see different issues now than you did when the program was started? And how are you working to address some of the issues? There's also the technology piece. There's the technical mm-hmm. divide. How are you going to challenge some of these issues?
We started many years ago with an anti-violence campaign. For me, it's personal. I spent 14 years in some of the most difficult communities in Washington, D.C. In the 14 years my office was located in this community, there were 17 homicides in that neighborhood. Mm-hmm. But it's a neighborhood I walk through 2 or 3 times a day, and engaged people who were not only affected by the trauma, but who had the courage and the fortitude and the strength to bring something positive to those communities. And so even though in the face of this tragedy of loss of life and disrespect for life, there were always people that had a positive outlook that brought something positive. Our challenge was how do we empower those people to continue to do what they're doing, to have a greater impact in these neighborhoods. We started an Ending the Violence essay contest. And our first idea was we're going to get kids in colleges like UDC and Howard to give us an idea on answering these 3 questions. What are the causes of violence in your community? What's your strategy for managing or eliminating those causes? And what steps do you take to implement that strategy? And so as we talked about this unusual question came up about, well, are there enough black kids in college? Are there more in college than in prison? You might remember that,
yes.
That debate, the apple oranges debate about where were the most kids. And so we said the reality was we can't talk about violence with just kids in college. We have to talk about violence with kids in prison too. So we set up a separate contest on the same delinea, 3 questions, with people in prison. And we identified the 40 cities in the country with the highest rates of incarceration and violence. And we offered those correction departments an opportunity to participate in these programs. Well, we were overwhelmed by the response. The state of Ohio put it in all 32 of their prisons. They were in prisons in Louisiana, prisons in Missouri, in Massachusetts, all over the country, this project resonated. And we began to get information from these corrections institutions that we have to do something for younger people. The first group was 19 to 29. I think that was our target group. Because my experience was that the shooters, the people who are really bringing the mayhem and murder, were in that age group. Maybe younger now, but in that time it was that age group. So the state of Ohio asked us if we could include kids under 19 in the program. So we set up a third contest for kids 14 to 19. Didn't matter if you were incarcerated or in school. And we're proud to say that high schools all over the country adopted this program for their schools, particularly Jackson, Mississippi, that put the program in all 8 of their high schools. So we know from this experience, we got over 600 entries in this campaign of answers to the question, what do we do about community violence? And the cluster of answers really is something almost like a constellation of stars. There's certain bright points in the answers that came up that we began to analyze. For kids, there were two issues. One had to do with parenting. One had to do with where's my father? How can you help my mother become more supportive of what I need? How can you get my father out of jail? Or how can we find a job for my parents? And how can I get the nurturing and strength that parents we hope parents can provide? Too often we hope it, but we don't ensure it. We don't do things to support it. And then the other cluster was, the music that I'm hearing, I'm being encouraged to be this kind of guy, and everybody else is being this. So how can I be different from the messages I'm getting in my music? And the message of today that kids are saturated in are really anti-life messages. Too often they're anti-life messages. I'm not criticizing the artist. I'm criticizing the broadcasters that continue to pump this music into the daily lives of our children. Artists are entitled to have kind of artistic freedom, but broadcasters have a responsibility to measure the messages that are coming out of what they broadcast. And I think our broadcasters have failed us miserably in terms of managing those messages. And one way I like to put it, Dr. Barber, is that when I was growing up, the messenger of my time was Martin Luther King. I have a dream. Right. Nobody's going to do this for us. We shall overcome. We have to fight to do things. When my children grew up, the Martin they talked about was Martin Lawrence. So, you know, the message is quite different. What's up? You go, girl. I mean, that's just not the same message. But kids today are getting the messages from music that say, get rich or die trying. And too often they're taking those messages to heart. So we have to do things to combat the messages that kids are getting every day. We have to find ways to get into the neighborhoods, bring our resources and activities and programs to where kids live, where they spend 80% of their time growing up. If we do a better job of that, we're going to reduce violence all over the country.
One of the concerns in looking at the data that young people have, and it seems to be consistent with what you're saying, is the absence of a father in a home, mm-hmm. the absence of a stable family structure. What are you doing, and what does United Black Front do in targeting males to provide opportunities and support for continuance and a continuing presence in the home?
Well, you know, one of the real phenomena we've had in the last 15 years particularly is the mass incarceration of black men for crimes that are nonviolent crimes, mm-hmm. but crimes of possession of drugs and the like. It's been just a staggering number of people locked up. And what we don't consider all the time is the experience that people who are locked up have in jail. It's almost as if we've turned our back on the mm-hmm. constitutional requirement that there should be no cruel and unusual punishment. Because too often, people who go to jail are expected to be brutalized, gang beaten, or raped. And if that's a common wisdom and conventional wisdom, there ought to be some effort to change that. But given the fact that so many people have had that experience, we're working with the 5 leading organizations in the Washington, D.C. area for returning citizens. And with those organizations, we're working to help on many things. 1, workforce development. 2, family counseling and connecting. We're working on educational and training. Those things are vital to a person who's been incarcerated coming back and being a productive citizen. We say they've paid their debt to society, but we continue to expect them to pay a burden once they come out. The other thing we do is that we have programs where people are working daily with parenting skills. Mm. There are father initiatives that we support, initiatives that are working with fathers to develop a greater sense of responsibility, a connectedness to the child that they have a responsibility for. And once you get parents and kids together, it doesn't take long for most kids can win that parent over. What hasn't been happening are those programs and those experiences that are intended to bring those groups together. And then sometimes you have to overcome great hostility with children who've been without a parent for whatever reason. And that's a level that requires a kind of professional presence. Very often you need professional counselors involved in joining parents with families when there's been no real support, no real effort, no real indication of love. And I think you find that most kids want to know that they're loved. And if they know that they're loved, they can sustain themselves if a parent is absent. So we're working with a number of groups that have this on their mind, that we're going to find ways to break down those barriers that exist. Not only barriers on the part of the child, but also barriers on the part of the parent. You know, parents can develop a guilt syndrome too, that leads them to belief that there's no place for them now in this child's life. They don't have the right to be involved in this child's life. And so it's not always the case that an absent parent, mother or father, is doing this because they just don't care. Sometimes they don't know how to express their care. Sometimes they think they have to have all the economic ability to take care of that child, and too often they don't have that. But it's a problem we have to engage. And I think if we continue to engage, we're going to have great success with it.
In such a political city as Washington is, are there any lobbying efforts being done? I'm thinking about the legislation that Councilman Barry sought to have passed, making it easier for those reentering to get employment.
We just shared with Councilmember Barry and Chairman Phil Mendelson information that we obtained from the Department of Labor. The Department of U.S. Department of Labor has come out with Directive 306, which in effect effectively makes returning citizen a protected class within certain requirements. And we think the legislation that Councilmember Barry supported, that Councilmember Mendelson did not support, can be resolved if they look at the format that's been developed by the U.S. Department of Labor. So we're actively involved in pursuing that issue with Council. In fact, we're scheduled to meet with Councilmember Mendelson's team, Mike Battle, to talk about this particular directive and this particular format as a way of overcoming the problems that people who are incarcerated have when they apply for a job and they have to identify themselves as an ex-offender. So we expect to have great success with that.
Where do you get your volunteers from at the Black United Front if someone wanted to offer their expertise and their skill?
Well, we have programs all the time that require volunteer support. The program we have coming up, the I Love Life program, would generate literally hundreds of essays, posters, perhaps less song but interesting songs, and lots of orations. We need volunteers to help us judge those and to award those kids their due for having tried. We have programs like the swimming meet where we take 150 volunteers for the swimming meet annually. And then we have a need to connect people with information to the organizations we're working with, because very often when people form an organization, they really expect to be able to start after they get their 501c3 the next day and go out and start doing some good, when it really takes so much more preparation than that. And so when we look at an organization's need to have financial guidance, then people who have experience in financial controls and accountants, people who've worked on 990s or budgets, can often volunteer with an organization, help an organization stay sharp in one of the most important areas they have to stay sharp in, which is financial control, or even when you talk about program activity. So we invite you to contact us. If people are interested in volunteering, they can contact us. We'll share with you all the agencies we work with. You might see somebody familiar or cause that you really want to get involved in, because it's really going to take us getting more and more involved in the work of the day that's being done to help people. And we can't take a vacation on this. We have to sustain our participation both politically and also in terms of our social service activity in our community. And so we look forward to, if you have a skill, we can put it to use, that's for sure.
Thank you so much. You've given us a lot to think about, and I just want to congratulate you on all that you do. Very quickly, what would be a real quick response to the what seems to be the question of the 21st century asked by those who don't understand? What is the need for a United Black Fund?
Well, we're a historic organization. We grow out of our history. We stand on the shoulders of people who were the 12 million people taken from Africa, 4 million brought to this country, enslaved, and fought their way through to freedom and then to develop a community of people that, where human, being human is the most important goal. And so as long as we're loyal to that mission and that history, there's going to be a need for us.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me, Dr. Barber.
If you would like more information about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website, www.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber. Thank you.
Well, thank you.